Welcome to the SARS Tax Practitioner Readiness Program. Module 2, Criteria for the Recognition of Controlling Bodies and Registration of Tax Practitioners. At the end of this module, you are expected to understand the following: the criteria for SARS to recognize a controlling body, requirements in relation to prospective and existing tax practitioner members, code of ethics and conduct of members, examples of when a tax practitioner might be in breach of code of ethics and conduct, tax practitioner registration requirements, and individuals who are exempt from registering as tax practitioners, and requirements for tax practitioners who change their RCBs. What is the criteria for SARS to recognize a controlling body? It is important to understand that for a controlling body to be recognized by the Commissioner of SARS as an RCB, it must meet the following criteria. For the entity, the following requirements are applicable. It must be a controlling body for natural persons who provide advice with respect to the application of a tax act or complete returns. It must be approved in terms of Section 30B of the Income Tax Act for purposes of Section 101D4 of that Act. It must have a minimum of 1,000 members or a reasonable expectation of reaching 1,000 members by the end of the first year of recognition. The entity must maintain the minimum qualifications and experience and continuing professional education requirements that are set by SARS and all RCBs. Relevant and effective codes of ethics and conduct, including tax compliance and criminal record requirements, and relevant and effective disciplinary process and procedures. When an entity is recognized as an RCB, it must submit an annual report which contains the information stipulated in the external guide to SARS not later than the 31st of March of the following year. The link of the external guide is provided at the end of this module. The following steps are to be followed for SARS to recognize the controlling body. The entity which desires to be recognized by SARS as a recognized controlling body must ensure that the minimum requirements listed on the Act are met. This pertains to the provisions as stipulated in the Chapter 18 of the Tax Administration Act, together with the provision stipulated in the Section 30B of the Income Tax Act. The entity must download the recognition as an RCB application form from the SARS website. The entity must complete the downloaded form. It is also important to refer to the SARS website on the steps on how to complete the form. The entity must email the completed form together with all the required supporting documentation to the Reporting and Professional Conduct at sars.gov.za mailbox. The entity must await SARS response indicating the success or rejection of the application. If successful, the RCB must submit a list of all their tax practitioner members to SARS on e-filing. It is also important to refer to the SARS website regarding the steps on how to submit information and maintain members using e-filing and registration as an RCB on e-filing. What are the requirements in relation to prospective and existing tax practitioner members? Please note that an RCB that intends to register an individual as a tax practitioner must ensure that the individual meets the requirements as set out in the external guide. Please note, we have previously indicated that the link to the external guide is available at the end of this module. An RCB must ensure that its existing tax practitioner members meet the requirements as already outlined in the external guide. Additionally, RCBs must verify at least 20% of its tax practitioner members' CPE records per year and retain the records of such verification. Verify the tax compliance status of tax practitioner members at least once a year and notify notify SARS as and when they have dismissed a member due to serious misconduct or become aware that a member has been convicted of an offence. What are the requirements with regard to the Code of Ethics and Conduct of members that RCBs are expected to comply with? It is important to note that RCBs should incorporate the following broad principles into their respective codes of conduct to reflect the responsibility of tax practitioner as well as to protect the public: honesty and integrity, professional competence, confidentiality and fees, and disciplinary code and procedures. Honesty and integrity as a code of ethic and conduct that RCB members are expected to abide with states that tax practitioners should be straightforward and honest in all professional and business relationships. Integrity requires fair dealing and truthfulness, which means that they must be compliant in respect of the taxation laws in the conduct of their personal affairs, be open and honest in respect of their criminal record, not knowingly be associated with reports, returns, communications, and other sources of information where the practitioner believes that the information contains materially false or misleading statements, contains statements or information furnished recklessly, or omits or obscures information required to be included. When a tax practitioner becomes aware that the above has occurred, the practitioner must cease to represent the taxpayer concerned if the taxpayer does not remedy the situation. Professional competence as a code of ethic and conduct that RCB members are expected to abide with states that tax practitioners must attain and maintain knowledge and skills relevant to the service provided to clients, take responsible care in ascertaining a client's state of affairs to the extent that ascertaining the state of those affairs is relevant to a statement being made on behalf of the client, whether in a written submission or otherwise, ensure that taxation laws are applied correctly and lawfully to the circumstances of that particular client, not knowingly obstruct the proper administration of the tax laws, ensure that they advise their clients of their rights and obligations under the taxation laws, and exercise due diligence and care in their interaction with SARS on behalf of their clients. Confidentiality and fees as a code of ethic and conduct that RCB members are expected to comply with states that tax practitioners must maintain the confidentiality of their clients' information and should not disclose information to a third party without a client's permission unless there is a legal obligation to do so. Information disclosed by the client should not be used by the tax practitioner for personal gain or advantage. Fees charged by a tax practitioner for work undertaken on behalf of a client must be commensurate with the nature and complexity of the task at hand. The charging of contingency fee for completion or revision of tax returns is not an acceptable form of remuneration for tax practitioners. However, the charging of a contingency fee is acceptable under the following circumstances: when there is a dispute between the taxpayer and SARS under Chapter 9 of the Tax Administration Act, and when the taxpayer brings an application for SARS to review its decision under Section 9 of the Tax Administration Act. Where contingency fees are allowed, the tax practitioner must enter into a written agreement with his or her client. The agreement should contain sufficient information on the details of the tax practitioner and the taxpayer, the outcome upon which the contingency fees are based, and its percentage. the consequences if the outcome is not achieved and when the contingency fees are charged. The agreement should also contain a clause that gives the taxpayer the right to refer the agreement to the relevant RCB for review, and the RCB has the authority to set aside any provision of the agreement or any fees claimable in terms of the agreement if the RCB finds such provision or fees unreasonable or unjust. The principles applicable to disciplinary code and procedures for tax practitioner membership should include the following: the types of complaints that may be lodged under Section 241 of the Tax Administration Act. Provision must be made for cases to be reported to the RCB by SARS, clients, other professional bodies, or members of the public. A list of offences and sanctions must be drawn up. Sanctions must fit the offence committed and address the severity and the effect of the non-compliant behaviour of a member. This could include warnings, a requirement that the tax practitioner undertake educational courses to increase competency in their practice, financial sanctions, suspension, or removal as a tax practitioner member. Repeated non-compliant behavior must receive a harsher sanction than was imposed previously, and outcomes of all disciplinary hearings of tax practitioners that have been found guilty must be reported to SARS as well as the client concerned. The controlling body must retain jurisdiction over its tax practitioner members, notwithstanding that they may have resigned, provided that the conduct under investigation took place at the time they were a member of the controlling body. The controlling body must require members to declare that they have not been removed from a controlling body for misconduct and that they do not have a criminal record as set out in Section 240, Subsection 3 of the Tax Administration Act. It is important to also note that an individual cannot be registered as a tax practitioner, and a tax practitioner cannot remain registered if during the preceding 5 years they have been removed by an RCB or the controlling body of a related profession for serious misconduct. The following are the examples of when a tax practitioner might be in breach of code of ethics and conduct. Tax practitioners being non-compliant with tax laws in their personal capacity or in their businesses. Failure to register for a tax type when required to do so. Under declaration, for an example, failure to submit accurate figures. Late or non-filing of returns. Late or non-payment of tax debt without payment arrangement or suspension of payment in place. When a client requests that a tax practitioner submit nil returns for them and the tax practitioner does so while being aware that the client is trading. Impersonate clients when engaging with SARS. Misrepresenting taxpayers' information. Illegal use of the SARS logo or trademark. Withholding a client's e-filing profile due to fees owed by the client. Charging of contingency fees for the submission of returns, not advising a client regarding the correct date of liability and registration for a tax type. For an example, client's turnover exceed 1 million rands, but the tax practitioner does not advise the client to register for VAT, and providing questionable advice which does not match the facts of the matter. Now, what are the tax practitioner registration requirements? To register as a tax practitioner, an individual must be registered with both an RCB and SARS. This means that an individual who wishes to register as a tax practitioner and is not yet registered with an RCB should ensure that they meet the requirements as stipulated in the criteria for the registration of tax practitioners and the recognition of controlling bodies guide, which is available on the SARS website, as well as the additional requirements specified by the RCB with which they choose to register with. Once the individual has registered with an RCB as a tax practitioner member, the individual is then required to register with SARS as a tax practitioner via their own e-filing. SARS requires the following from an individual who wishes to register as a tax practitioner. The individual must be registered with an RCB, and the individual must have an active tax reference number. An individual who is not registered as a tax practitioner must register as a tax practitioner within 21 business days after the date on which they for the first time provide tax advice or complete or assist in completing a return on behalf of another for a fee or cease such activities. The admission requirements that an individual who intends to register as a tax practitioner or an RCB who intends to register an individual as a tax practitioner member are as follows. With regard to qualifications and experience, an individual must have NQF level 6 and above with at least one accounting module and one tax module plus at least 1 year tax working experience. NQF level 5 plus at least 4 years tax working experience or NQF level 4 plus 10 years tax working experience. It is important to note that the tax working experience must be verifiable by employers or clients. The individual must successfully complete the SARS Tax Practitioner Readiness Program. The individual must be tax compliant. The individual must not have been removed by a controlling body for serious misconduct in the preceding 5 years or not have been convicted of an offence as described in the next slide. An individual cannot be registered as a tax practitioner, and a tax practitioner cannot remain registered if their criminal record reflects that during the preceding 5 years, they have been convicted, whether in the Republic or elsewhere, of a serious tax offence as defined in Section 1 of the Act, or theft, fraud, forgery, uttering a forged document, perjury, an offence under the Prevention and Combating of Corrupt Activities Act No. 12 of 2004, or any other offence involving dishonesty for which the person has been sentenced to a period of imprisonment exceeding 2 years without the option of a fine or to a fine exceeding the amount prescribed in the Adjustment of Fines Act No. 101 of 1991. It is important to note that an individual who aspires to register as a tax practitioner has to meet the following requirements with regard to criminal record. The individual must submit an independently verified criminal record check to their RCB. For an example, a certificate issued by the South African Police Service. The certificate must not be older than 3 months from the date of issue. Once registered, the tax practitioner must produce an annual confirmation indicating that their criminal status remains unchanged. Once every 5 years, an affidavit indicating that the tax practitioner's criminal record remains in compliance with the above must be produced and provided to RCBs or at shorter time period as specified by their RCBs. A registered tax practitioner must ensure that they adhere to the continuous professional education requirements that are set out as follows. A tax practitioner must have a minimum of 18 verifiable continuous professional education hours per year, which consists of 10 tax hours, 2 ethics hours, and 6 hours relating to the service provided. And a tax practitioner is required to retain a record of their CPE for 5 years, for an example, competency certificates. It is important to note that a year commences on the 1st of January and ends on the 31st of December of a year, and therefore the 18 hours is calculated on a pro rata basis for newly registered tax practitioners depending on the registration date. It is important to note that an individual who has been previously charged of serious misconduct by a recognized controlling body is barred from registering as a tax practitioner. An individual cannot be registered as a tax practitioner, and a tax practitioner cannot remain registered if during the preceding 5 years they have been removed by an RCB or the controlling body of a related profession for serious misconduct. Tax practitioners are required to adhere to the following. At the time of joining an RCB with the aim of registering as a tax practitioner, an individual must declare to the RCB truthfully whether they have been removed by a previous RCB or a controlling body of a related profession for serious misconduct. An individual who aspires to be registered as a tax practitioner must be tax compliant. And it is also important to note that a registered tax practitioner must remain tax compliant with all the tax products they are registered with SARS. An individual cannot be registered as a tax practitioner, and a tax practitioner cannot remain registered if during the preceding 12 months they have for an aggregate period of at least 6 months not been tax compliant to the extent referred to in Section 256, Subsection 3 of the Tax Administration Act, and have failed to demonstrate that they have been tax compliant for that period, or remedy the non-compliance within the period specified in a notice by SARS. Tax practitioners are required to provide to their RCBs their tax compliance data at the time of registration and annually or at shorter period as specified by the RCB. In this slide, the emphasis will be on tax practitioners who change their RCBs. This applies to all tax practitioners moving between RCBs, regardless of whether the releasing RCB is an active RCB or ceases to be an RCB for any reason. The following definitions will apply. Releasing RCB means the RCB that a registered tax practitioner was previously registered with and has ceased to be a member thereof for any reason. Receiving RCB means the RCB that a registered tax practitioner joins after leaving the releasing RCB. Amended criteria refers to the criteria for recognition of controlling bodies and requirements for registration of tax practitioners amended in 2022 with an effective date of the 1st of June 2022. What are the requirements when a tax practitioner changes their RCB due to resignation? A tax practitioner resigns from the releasing RCB due to perceived advantages of the receiving RCB, or the releasing RCB ceases to be recognized either voluntarily or in terms of the Act. A registered tax practitioner is required to provide the receiving RCB with a letter of good standing issued by the releasing RCB. This letter should not be more than 6 months old. The letter should at least contain the following information of the tax practitioner: the full name, the identity number or passport number, the practitioner number, the date of the registration, and the date of the resignation of the tax practitioner, and information on the member indicating that continuous professional education is up to date, tax compliance was verified and proved to be compliant, a criminal verification check status was provided, and there are no pending disciplinary cases against the member. if a registered tax practitioner has joined the receiving RCB in the period of less than 6 months from the resignation date and has submitted the letter of good standing, they must be treated as follows. Minimum qualification and working experience. If they were registered as a tax practitioner prior to the 1st of June 2022, the requirements in the 2013 criteria document will therefore be applicable. Or if they were registered as a tax practitioner on or after the 1st of June 2022, the amended criteria will therefore be applicable. If individuals were registered as tax practitioners prior to the 1st of July 2022, the requirement for successfully passing the SARS Tax Practitioner Readiness Program assessment does not apply, although they are encouraged to attend to the SARS Tax Practitioner Readiness Program. If they were registered as a tax practitioner on or after the 1st of July 2022, they are required to provide evidence of having passed the assessment. The evidence may be a letter from the releasing RCB or a certificate issued by the institution who conducted the assessment. They must be tax compliant at the time of joining the receiving RCB. They are required to submit an affidavit stating that they have not committed any crime listed in Section 240, Subsection 3 of the Tax Administration Act. They are required to provide the evidence of the continuous professional education status for the year. If a registered tax practitioner has joined the receiving RCB 6 months or longer after the resignation from the releasing RCB, they are treated as a new registration. Hence, all the amended criteria must be met. What are the requirements in a case whereby the tax practitioner changed their RCB as a result of their membership having been terminated? This covers the situation where a tax practitioner's membership is terminated by the releasing RCB due to non-compliance with its rules. Where a tax practitioner's membership was terminated by the releasing RCB, they will not be issued with a letter of good standing. Therefore, no receiving RCB is allowed to register them as a tax practitioner. And the tax practitioner may only be registered with a receiving RCB once they meet all the registration requirements as stipulated under a change of RCB due to resignation, as previously discussed in the previous slide. In this slide, we will be discussing the requirements in a case whereby the tax practitioner changed their RCB due to serious misconduct or court judgment. If a tax practitioner's membership is deregistered by the releasing RCB or the tax practitioner status is deregistered by SARS in terms of Section 240, Subsection 3, Paragraph A, or Section 240, Subsection 3, Paragraph B, or Section 240, Subsection 3, Paragraph C of the Act, the following requirements will apply. No RCB is permitted to register them as a tax practitioner unless the period of 5 years from the date of the deregistration by the releasing RCB or the date of the conviction has lapsed, or after the 5 year period has lapsed, a receiving RCB may register the individual as a tax practitioner if they meet the amended criteria. This is treated as a new registration. What are the requirements if a tax practitioner intends to change their RCB as a result of having been deregistered due to continuous tax non-compliance? A tax practitioner's membership is deregistered by the releasing RCB or the tax practitioner status is deregistered by SARS in terms of Section 240, Subsection 3, Paragraph D of the Tax Administration Act. No RCB is permitted to register a deregistered tax practitioner as a tax practitioner unless they can demonstrate to the receiving RCB that they have been tax compliant for at least 6 months in the preceding 12 months. once the individual has demonstrated that they have been tax compliant for at least 6 months in the preceding 12 months, a receiving RCB may register them as a tax practitioner if they meet the amended criteria. This is treated as a new registration. What are the requirements in a case whereby the tax practitioner changed their RCB due to suspension by the RCB or by SARS? A tax practitioner's membership may be suspended by the RCB they are registered with, or their tax practitioner status may be suspended by SARS in terms of Section 240, Subsection 4 of the Tax Administration Act. If prosecution for a serious tax offence has been instituted but not finalised against a registered tax practitioner, and if the registered tax practitioner continues with the commission of a serious tax offence after the criminal proceedings have been instituted, SARS must suspend the registration of the registered tax practitioner in terms of Section 240, Subsection 4 of the Tax Administration Act, and their RCB must suspend their membership. Once fully acquitted, their RCB must reactivate their tax practitioner status. If the tax practitioner wishes to change their RCB after the reactivation of the tax practitioner status, the requirement similar to change of RCB due to resignation will apply. Please refer to the guide as per the link below for more information on the criteria for the recognition of controlling bodies and the registration of tax practitioners, or by referring to the SARS website, www.sars.gov.za. This brings us to the end of Module 2, the criteria for the recognition of controlling bodies and the registration of tax practitioners. Thank you.